If you want to study fish, you have to find them first, and that can be a challenge. So researchers across the Great Lakes are deploying a network of underwater devices to track the fish and their movements.
One of the challenges of studying fish is that they live in the water and, well, we don't. To find fish in the past, researchers relied on data from commercial or recreational fishers or surveys they conducted. But that data only gave them a snapshot of one place at one point in time. These days, researchers have better tools. The Chicago River, with its hardened shorelines, frequent dredgings, and industrial history, would not seem to offer a lot of opportunities from a fish's perspective. Dr. Austin Happel, a research biologist at Chicago's Shedd Aquarium, is hoping the fish can tell him where the best spots are.
The Chicago River is almost fully man-made and rather devoid of habitat. So we're interested in trying to understand what habitats fish find important within the Chicago River, and we can then use that information to better inform our restoration activities.
Happel has a number of ways to find out where the fish are. But the method that gives him the best data is acoustic telemetry.
Throughout the Chicago River, we have 32 receivers out listening for our acoustic fish.
By acoustic fish, Happel means fish that carry a tag, like this one. The tags send out a unique audio signal that identifies each fish, and a network of receivers listens for those signals 24/7. When a tagged fish comes close enough to hear, the receivers record the time and date the signal was heard. The result is a series of check-ins that show researchers where that fish has traveled and when. Thousands of underwater receivers have been deployed across the Great Lakes to enable researchers to track fish movements. On Lake St. Clair and connecting waterways between Michigan and Ontario, Andrew Briggs, a fish biologist with the Michigan Department of Natural Resources, is using acoustic telemetry to track a range of fish.
There's around 100 receivers in the area here. This year we've tagged northern pike, smallmouth bass, moon eye, and juvenile lake sturgeon. Over the years we've tagged walleye, yellow perch, and musky too.
The data that comes back from all of those tagged fish is far richer than the data from fish surveys, and it's easier to get.
With most surveys, you're only going to find fish where you look for them, but with acoustic telemetry, we got receivers throughout the Great Lakes, and now that allows us to look all over the Great Lakes more passively. You don't have to actively be out there setting nets.
But Briggs can't just look at real-time data on his smartphone, at least not yet. For now, to get the data, his team needs to collect the receivers they've placed, which can spend up to a year underwater.
The data generally is maintained within the receiver itself. Some receivers can float up to the surface when you send a signal to it. Some you have to physically go down and get.
The Great Lakes Acoustic Telemetry Observation System, GLATOS, is a collective effort. More than 100 organizations maintain the receivers. Altogether, there are more than 2,000 in all five lakes in both U.S. and Canadian waters. All those organizations are part of GLATOS, which itself is part of GLOSS, the Great Lakes Observing System, which manages data collected through a range of techniques. Shelby Brunner is the Science and Observations Manager at the Great Lakes Observing System.
When you hear of really great examples of coordinated science, GLATOS is at the top of that list in many cases because they've done such a good job making this information shareable among their communities and applying it in thoughtful ways.
Researchers can request information for certain tags, and GLATOS will provide data gathered system-wide.
When scientists tag fish, they can label the tag in this overarching database that manages all of the fish tags around the Great Lakes. So when the DNR sends you in that fish tag and says, hey, I want to know what happened to juvenile sturgeon 36 nicknamed George, you can look up George.
Only a select number of fish are given acoustic tags each year, as the units are expensive and require a surgical procedure to be implanted. The tags stay inside the fish for their lifetime, which often ends when they are caught by anglers. State agencies like the Michigan Department of Natural Resources have a variety of tag reward programs for anglers.
There's a phone number where an angler can report that they recaptured a fish. We'll get that information back from them, and we can give them information on the fish, like when we tagged it and how long it's been at large.
Acoustic tracking data is already rewriting many long-standing fisheries beliefs. For a long time, it was thought that muskellunge tend to stay in a relatively small area. But that idea was shattered by one muskie with a tag number 007.
So it was tagged in the Detroit River, migrated all the way to Buffalo, New York, and then came back. It took it about 2 months to get to Buffalo, New York. It stayed over there for 3 to 4 months, came back to the Detroit River in about a month's time, and then it repeated that movement pattern again in 2018.
In Chicago, Austin hoped tracking would reveal sunfish spawning sites and found that one bluegill was a traveler, much like 007.
We were able to tag about a dozen or so bluegill or sunfish. We have one that really likes to go all the way up and down our river multiple times. We've tracked him making a 6 mile journey about a dozen times, and he'll do that 6 miles in about a day. So we're interested, if we tag other bluegill, how many of them are doing these like marathons versus how many of them are more homebodies?
Tracking also showed largemouth bass hanging out in barge slips, suggesting that these remnants of Chicago industry contain minnows and other food for predatory bass to feed on. Sometimes knowing where the fish don't go is also helpful.
Here on Lake St. Clair, we've seen a couple different species now where they seem to avoid crossing the shipping channel. We started tagging fish on the Canadian side. It'll be interesting once we download the receivers whether we see those smallmouth bass coming over into the U.S. side of the shipping channel.
The absence of common carp in an area can likewise raise questions.
If a common carp can't withstand being in an area, that means nothing can withstand being in that area.
Understanding how fish can use large urban cities like Chicago, how far they are traveling, and where they are finding refuge are just a few of the questions researchers are trying to unlock.
It also shows you how, I had no idea that was happening, and it leads to more questions, and hopefully you can get more answers through acoustic telemetry.
Thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to like and subscribe, and check out our YouTube channel for even more Great Lakes Now. See you out on the lakes.